Hi everyone, welcome to Funk Family Showcase. I'm Samantha Echo, as your host today, filling in for Troy Weeks, who is our regular host. And I have with me a very special guest, somebody I admire very much. You may know him from the Broadway stage, from the off-Broadway stage, from television, from music, from SoundCloud, from YouTube. The man, the myth, the legend, Ryan McCurdy.
Oh, hello, Samantha. Thank you so much.
You startled me.
I didn't
kind of. Not, I mean, not
apologize.
Really.
I was trying. I was endeavoring to make an entrance, and then I realized I didn't have any sticks, so it wasn't going to be.
Oh, okay. That's a problem.
Yeah.
You could have just like.
I could have just wandered out.
Be careful. Don't step on your guitar.
Thank you. Hi, okay. Samantha.
Hi, Ryan.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you. I'm excited to be here on the show, and as much as I enjoy watching Troy do the interviews, I'm personally delighted that it's you conducting my interview today.
Oh, thank you.
We have been friends for a very long time.
Yeah.
And I've played on many of your recordings.
Yeah, you have. He has, actually. So Ryan's multi-talented, and that's one of the reasons why I'm so amazed by him, and I admire him so much, because I feel like he's an actor. He's a professional actor, and I'm going to ask him about his training in a little while. He's been in off-Broadway shows, both straight plays and musicals. He's trained as a singer as well, and he's an accomplished guitarist and a singer-songwriter, both in solo projects and in other, his band Bonfire Falls, who of which I am a great fan. So I sort of, and what's also, he's very interesting as a person, too. So I wanted to ask him, you're originally from Virginia, right?
Yeah, well, that's where my family is now, but I grew up in Charlotte, yeah, which is, to a lot of people, North Carolina and Virginia are the same state anyway.
Well, so. They're both, to me, I'm from New York as a Yankee, they're both just the South.
Yeah, like, and they have very similar mountains. Like the mountains that start in North Carolina just carry through Virginia. So there's a contiguous thing going on.
Okay, so they're kind of, it depends on how you see boundaries. I feel like boundaries are kind of, I'm a Pisces, so I feel like boundaries are just an illusion.
I think state lines are bizarre. And I when I was little, and we would be at various state lines. And first I went to the U.S.-Mexico border, one of the places that you could easily cross.
Yeah.
I was one of the ones that I was like this just doesn't make sense. A foot in either one. I'm like,
that's
I kept expecting like one foot to like feel like super special or something. I'm like, oh my goodness, it's all the same planet. That's an important thing for us all to think about sometimes.
That's great. How old were you? Were you just like 10 years old or like 5?
We went to visit my aunt Elsie in Texas, and we went then. So I think I was like 7. Yeah, I think I was 7 or so. But it was a great learning experience, because I think you're taught that state lines are a real thing, or like country borders are a real thing. And it's just the delineation of a group of people. Like that, it's just, you know, majority rule. That's how they're made. Crazy.
Yeah, well, I feel like in a country like the U.S., they are kind of a real thing, but also I feel like the Northeast, the South, the Midwest, and the West all have a different character to them. I feel like we have like these, those are where the real borders are, just the different regions of the states. And I know you've lived in Virginia also, and also Georgia, right?
In Georgia. I was in Georgia almost as long as I was in Charlotte, yes.
And now you're just, I can't even imagine you there. You're such a New Yorker. Like, when I think of New York, you're like the prince. You're like I think of you as the quintessential New Yorker, because you've worked on Broadway, and you've been here for a while now, and you're sort of like, you're always on the move, you're always doing stuff. So how did you become this this New York prince that we so know and love?
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I think, because, you know, being in the South, I think you pick up some good habits being in the South. Like, there is a reality to, like, the genteel nature. Like, there is a gentlemanly training that goes on down there.
Okay.
But I think I started feeling the itch, like, when I was, like, in my mid-teens, and I was like, I just... You know, no matter how you slice it, and no matter how many amazing cities there are in the United States that are making incredible theater, there's a truth to the faction that everybody auditions through New York. Like, everybody comes through New York. Penn Station is the station that everybody goes through. And I had this sort of yen to come up here and be part of that. Mm-hmm. And it was actually, I don't know that I would have made the leap, except I had a massive, devastating breakup about 8 years ago.
Okay.
And it was that sort of like the South, not just Georgia, but like the South isn't big enough for the two of us in this
right.
moment.
Right, I totally understand that. Yeah,
and I was like, there's no state I can go to in the South. So let me go to that place I've always talked about.
Right.
And people in Georgia at that point were making fun of me. You know, they were like, oh, Ryan, I thought you were in New York. And I'm like, you've been talking about that for like 3 years. I'm like, okay, I'm really going.
Oh my God, that's so funny.
On the train.
Oh my God, that's so funny. Because that was like me when I went to England this summer. Because I've been talking about it for years and years. And I'm like, I'm going to go to England to find a boyfriend. They're going to like me a lot better there. And I was right. They did like me a lot better there.
Well,
I was a lot more popular. So it was like, you talk about something and then you finally do it. And it's like, I feel like a lot of people when they travel, they are kind of trying to escape something. But it's sort of, sometimes it's that, I don't want to say trauma because it's not always a trauma, but that it's sometimes you need that fire under your buttocks. Or I don't know if I'm allowed to say the word, the expression.
I think that was great the way you said it.
Yeah, you need that fire underneath you to like to push you forward sometimes. And I think that's how I write, and I know this next song is sort of it's related to that feeling. And I always wanted this song's always been very mysterious to me. I love it, and I think it's an appropriate transition because it's about that, and it's also the name of a state is in the song. So let's do that song.
So this is a song called Alaska. It has nothing to do with the state of Alaska. That we go, what it took to get there, and the footsteps in the snow, and all this paper shredding. You won't know till anyone was lost, or how it came about, or the full and total cost, or that I've been left here alone. This day, it's grace.
Funkadelic Studios. We do a show here every second Saturday. It's called Level Up Showcase, and it features youth performers and veteran artists, some of the best in the city and out of the city. So do you want to perform? Do you want to level up? Hit us up on Instagram or Twitter at Level Up Showcase. Every second Saturday, I see y'all here.
How about that? What a voice, everyone. What a voice. It's like you
the
got...
The studio audience is losing their
minds.
You got
I know all y'all are watching. We're going to put this on. This is on YouTube. I'm saying this to future us. We're on YouTube right now because we're filming this. It's not like we're filming it live. Right? I mean, we're filming it live for the app, but this is going on YouTube. So to everyone, what a voice, right?
Thanks, man.
Was that not thrilling? That was thrilling.
You're a great interviewer. You put us at ease and you make us feel good.
Thank you. So I sort of, you remind me a little bit of Billy Joel. And I've heard you do covers of Billy Joel. So you have so much power and purity in your voice, but it also works for different genres of music. So do you have a musical theater background, right? Did you train in classical or did you train in musical theater?
I honestly didn't train in either. My undergrad it was sort of a catch-all performing arts degree at Savannah College of Art and Design, and it has since the program there has evolved into having specialties. But at the time, it was kind of the liberal arts. It was a liberal arts background, and then it was sort of like hang this gel, sing this song, do the Shakespearean monologue. So I would say my training is sort of in everything to a degree, but I've had no conservatory training. So I think it's interesting. I found my musical theater voice early. Like I was singing in musicals all the time growing up, like starting at like 11. And then like the blue-eyed soul, like the sort of like the edge of the voice is something I really didn't find until about 25 or 26.
I still haven't found it.
Well, no, it's interesting because you're classically trained.
Yeah, that's a long story, but when you mentioned the thing about being 11 and being in shows, like that's kind of how, in just picking it up, I learned by listening to Disney movies. And so I just kind of picked it up by ear, and then the classical training came second, but I sort of, so I'm a combination. But sort of, it's interesting because when you, it's kind of like, it's interesting because we have voices that are kind of associated with musical theater because they're very pure and like, they're very like powerful. So, and I know you've done musical theater, so do you ever get, but I know you do all different sorts of genres. Do you ever feel like people are pressuring you to just focus on one thing and that like you, and people want you to pigeonhole yourself in a way, or do you feel just like you're fine being spread out and you're just Ryan and everything is just fine?
That's a really great question. Interestingly, I think the answer to the first part is no one is putting that pressure on me, and sometimes that's actually worse, because what it lets me do is sort of careen. I feel sometimes like I'm careening wildly through my own life, and you know, like this year I've been on the road for a lot of this year, and I've gotten to do some extraordinary shows. Like I've been acting with an instrument in my hand since about February. But I feel like the way that those jobs are connected is through the independent relationships and the incredible people that I have the ability to work with, more so than me being told what to do. So I feel like sometimes I would love a little bit more structure, but I don't know who would be in my life to tell me how to do it.
Right.
I think I haven't had an agent in quite a while, and I feel like they would probably be someone. I'm seeking representation right now. I feel like that would be someone that would tell me what it is I should do.
Okay.
And I would like a little bit of that.
Yeah.
But I also know my personality type, that I'm gonna want to like fray at the edges of whatever I'm told to do anyway.
He's an Aries, Capricorn Moon, Libra Rising, Midheaven, and Cancer. For all everyone who wants to do his chart and advise him, and he's seeking both representation and an astrological advisor.
Yes, I actually have an astrological advisor in California.
Oh, okay.
We'll put her information up on the website.
Good. Yeah.
Great.
No, because I'm a lay astrological advisor. It's a hobby of mine. But that's really interesting because I guess I'm similar in that I did musical theater as a kid. And I did some opera, and then I started writing my own songs. So how did you start writing music? And I'd like to talk about the song you just did, Alaska.
Yeah, it's super latent. Like finding my voice. I kind of did the reverse of Billy Joel, who's, you know, which he's one of the greatest storytellers of our time. But he has this big raw throaty voice, and then when he was adapted for the stage, like he was adapted for the stage by Twyla Tharp. He has written these incredible symphonic pieces for orchestra. He has found his classical and his music theater on the back end, whereas I feel like I'm moving more into sort of what my singer songwriter feel is.
Yeah.
I started writing songs when I couldn't not do it anymore, and I think I put it off as long as possible. Like I wrote a terrible song when I was like 16 or 17, and I thought, well, and you know, in a lot of people, that's the first of many that they write before they get to college. I put it away, because I was like, I'm very stubborn when I don't get things right the first time.
Me too.
And I was like, this songwriting is not the thing. So then it was mid-20s, and Alaska was one of the first things I ever wrote.
Tell me how that came to you, and what your process was for that song, whether it's different for other songs, or, you know.
Yeah, I think it's good that we're both talking, because we both love the influence of mythology and fable to our songwriting. And I feel like I really only write two types of songs. I write mythological songs, or I write like detailed recollections of a particular moment in time. And I like Alaska because it has both, and it's for me. And it's based on an actual relationship in which there was. There was one particular table at a diner on the Upper West Side that was like the one place that we could find time to be together.
Oh, wow.
And I started treating the diner like Alaska, because it felt like it was this remote place.
Oh, wow.
That I would see her when I was there, and then I wouldn't see her anywhere else. And so like the whole idea of this like place that it's in the United States of America. Like, it should be so accessible, and you can get on a plane 12 times a day from JFK and be there, and it felt like it was the middle of nowhere.
Wow, that's really deep. Okay, so I think that's a good transition into your next song, which is Dinosaurs and Stars, am I right? Because we have all this imagery in your song.
Yeah.
I feel like you're very poetic.
So I will tell you now about a father sitting with his son. It's the end of the day when all those battles have been won. The boy said, how thick's that glass? From his lips escaped a small moan. So father shook his head and laughed, said, don't you worry, they'll leave you alone. Where I feel so small, corridor, hall by hall, and I will trust you in this, and you will not let me fall. As we stand and see nothing at all, as we stand and see nothing. Tell you now about a couple staring at the void. The girl said that's what comes from a life lived overjoyed. And when I met you, baby, you came into my life on your white steed. Kiss for good luck and compass is all that we'll need. Well, that's what she said to me. Take me to the places where it feels so small. Corridor by corridor and hall by hall, and I will trust you in this, and I will not let you fall. And we stand and say nothing at all. Say nothing, and I have no preconceptions about the way that this will go. I just thought that we'd be perfect, and I thought that you should know that I have no preconceptions about the way that this will go. I just thought that we'd be perfect, and I thought that you should know. And someday we'll understand. And someday I swear we'll understand the mysteries. Yeah. Of dinosaurs and stars. Dinosaurs and stars.
If you are a musician in NYC and you haven't visited Funkadelic Studios yet, what are you waiting for? We've been around for about a quarter of a century, offering services to musicians of all skill levels. Some of the services we offer are rental, repair, recording studio, rehearsal space, rock and roll club, and of course, retail. That's right, we can sell you equipment. And you can even do your events here. We have a beautiful, spacious room right back there. It's called Room 1, and we have lots of other rooms where you can do lots of other things. So come on down, show us what you got. So you were mentioning a play.
Yes, it's called Brilliant Traces, and I was trying to tie it in when we were talking about Alaska, because It's a play that's set in Alaska in this very remote cabin, and these two characters are thrown together in very strange, mysterious circumstances and have to figure out how to cohabitate or or succumb to the wilderness. And so that's where the name Alaska, that's where the title Alaska came from. And so it's so funny because like plays really, they get stuck in a place in your brain that only song lyrics and nothing else gets stuck. So it's like important dates, my social security number, they all float around, but Brilliant Traces and song lyrics are always there, so.
For me, it's like outfits that I was wearing.
Oh, really?
On certain days. Like, I remember what everybody was wearing the first day I met them.
Now, that's incredible.
But,
That's incredible. Do you tie it?
Yours is better.
Do you tie it into a mnemonic device? Like, does it help you with names, or is it completely disconnected for you?
It helps me a little bit with names. Yeah, I remember, it's an interesting thing. I remember when, on my third birthday, I was wearing a red dress, and it's just there.
That's cool.
It's just a useless bit of information that I'm good at remembering.
But it's obviously, it's not useless because your brain has decided it's not useless.
That's true. Yeah. So I guess, I don't know, but I say I have a good memory for certain things. I'd say that's sort of it. It's probably connected neurologically to my memory for song lyrics and for other things.
I love that. That's so cool.
Yeah. There's probably some sort of brain scan that they haven't invented yet to test for that.
2200, they'll have figured it out by then.
They will.
Yeah.
If we get a 2200, well, we'll see. Anyway, so tell me about the song Dinosaurs and Stars. That's a love song about the Museum of Natural History, right?
It is.
Yes.
And it's the only one, as far as I know. And I keep trying to figure out the best way to like present it to them. So maybe it was how we did it just then. I would love for the. It is available for licensing for all of their events. But the first verse, and the reason it's called Dinosaurs and Stars, because it was based on two very specific encounters that I had there same day with this young father and his son having this like incredibly this emotional bond, and he was terrified of the dinosaurs.
Really?
and the idea that they could come back to life. And then this couple who in this, it seemed like they might be approaching a breakup later in the day at the museum, and they were. It seemed like she had brought him to the galaxy, the whole a planetarium area, as if to set him up for the reality that the world is very big.
Oh my God!
So if you need to fly, if for instance you suddenly were free, look at all the things that you could do. Yeah, and I don't know how that. I don't know how either of those stories resolved, whether he got over his fear of the dinosaurs, the young boy, or whether they broke up later, because. You know, I'm as a songwriter, you have that fine line of like overhearing and processing versus just being a creeper and following people around.
No, but I think it's important to be a creeper and following people around because it's otherwise you're just self-absorbed. I think it's sort of. And what's interesting about that song is that it's interesting because it seems it. I didn't know whether it was about you or about other people, but it kind of it's very specific vignettes of interpersonal interactions, and then. It's sort of a philosophical meditation on the largeness of the world and how being in this place can make you experience that and make you identify it with these relationships and these interactions. But it doesn't make those small interactions seem any smaller. It makes them seem, somehow they can seem just as big, even when you're thinking about, you're contemplating the vastness of the universe. And so it's a very deep song. I really like it.
And there you have it, folks. Thank you. Yeah, and it's the only place in the world that you could find those two vignettes based on those two very like vastly different is a museum. And that's why I love museums, because they're trying to trap the entirety of some element of human history inside of four walls. And it's ultimately it's an impossible task. But the ones that do it really well, like natural history, you're like, how are you showing me how I'm a human just inside this, like, you know, half a block? It's incredible. Yeah.
I totally get that.
Yeah. Cool.
And I wanted to ask you one question about the South. So you don't speak with a Southern accent anymore,
I
right?
Don't,
but
no.
you did at one time, right?
Yeah. Well, and none of my family, some of the McCurdys have slightly thicker Southern accents.
Really?
My parents do not, and I started to adopt one when I was in Georgia.
Oh, okay.
And it kind of the edges of it fell off when I got to New York, so.
That's really interesting. Okay, that was it's very exotic to me because I'm a fifth generation New Yorker, so I'm just I'm curious.
I do say things like I say things like woof, which there you go. I think instead of I guess what is it in New York, like a wolf, right? Like you, the animal, a wolf.
A wolf.
And I say it's a wolf.
That's really funny.
So there you go.
Okay, so Ryan and I are gonna sing a duet now.
Yeah.
every last Friday of the month. All right, so please come out. And the soul sessions are exactly that. They are a session for everyone's souls. You know, like, life is crazy. Everyone has their challenges and their tribulations. The soul sessions is a place you can come, just get that healing from music and just the vibes that are around in the area. And from all the different kinds of artists, please come out. We have 10 open micers. Anyone can sign up for that. So just show up early. And we have 3 amazing features for you guys every time to just blow your mind. So definitely come out every last Friday, and we hope to see you guys. All right.
So that was the Tonight Duet from West Side Story.
Yes.
We did that like 2 years ago.
At the Duplex.
At the Duplex,
Darius Frowner, tremendous music director.
Yes. It's on YouTube, actually. Yeah.
We'll put that up on the website.
Yeah. That was fun.
All right. Hey.
Yeah. So you're not wearing any shoes.
No, I'm not. I'm trying it.
You have nicer feet than I do. I'm jealous.
Thought it'd be fun today. Because it's like, I'm fighting the onslaught of winter,
yes.
So I'm like wearing sandals everywhere, yes. And I was like, I can see my feet in the shot, I'm gonna do no shoes.
Okay.
Yeah. Also, I just like being shoeless. I do. It's a new look. I'm not sure if I'm gonna try it at the bitter end, because there's been a lot of liquid spilled on that floor.
Yeah, you might wanna protect yourself. Just wear like, make a plaster cast of your shoe, and then make it into a leather cast of a plaster cast of your foot.
So make shoes, is what you're telling me to do?
No, make shoes that look like your feet. But they'll like secretly be made out of leather. They'll be like Leather Ryan feet.
Excellent, Leather Ryan feet. That's the name of my next album.
They'll be based on your feet. But
I'm a cobbler.
You could be a cobbler.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, so your next show at the Bitter End, it is October 18th.
It is at 10 p.m. Thursday.
10 p.m. Thursday, October 18th. Bitter End.
$10 at the door, but there will be a link on my website, realryanmccurdy.com, for $7 tickets. And if you buy at the $7 rate, you not only save money to see me and a tremendous group of backing musicians that are mind-blowingly good, but you'll get my new EP when it comes out. So you're investing. It's sort of like you're investing in the work that is coming by paying $7.
That's a pretty good deal.
Yeah, because the EP will probably sell for $9.99, so it's like you're saving $2.99. I love it.
No, and so this next EP is that. The one that's called Once Removed.
Yes.
And I have to ask.
Yeah.
Is it like a pun on once, or is it just?
It is. It's a double pun, actually.
Okay.
I recently found myself in a change of relationship status, so I had already been thinking about using the title Once Removed, because this was the year that I got to actually be in Once for the first time, which was a really magical experience. But I was thinking, like, I accomplished that goal, and like, what does it feel like after you get everything that you want? So it's like Once has been removed from my list of goals.
Okay, so Once Removed is it is a concept. Is it an EP or is it a full length album?
It's going to be it's shaping up to be an EP. It's because I have 5 very specific stories to tell around the theme of Once Removed, and they all kind of stem from this idea, which I love, that that so many people are they say. You're 50% looking for your other 50%. When you find the person you're supposed to be with, you will be 100% together. Mm. And I'm far more interested in the reality of trying very hard to be the 100% of yourself, and that you're finding someone that becomes the whole is greater than the sum, rather than someone that completes you, because I think that that's a very scary thing. So the cover art, the song lyrics, the 5 very specific stories I want to tell are all based around that idea.
That's great.
Of finding out who you are.
Wow, I love it. I love it. I think that's, I would go into a whole like philosophical musing on how I think that it's amazing that in 2018 we still think about being 50% of a person and needing someone to complete us. But then again, it does go back to Aristotelian philosophy, I think. Mm-hmm. I wrote an essay on this actually, where it was based on the idea that we as human beings we were once whole and that we were like ripped apart from ourselves
and we're
looking for our other half.
Hedwig and Grange talks about that.
Yes. That there's a song about that. Yeah. So I think I'd love to hear your take on it. I think that's a really interesting concept.
Thanks. So it'll be coming out hopefully at the top of next year.
So Once Removed. Wow. Okay, cool. And I just think it's so cool that you worked on Once so many times. I just must say that.
Now I've worked on Once 4 times.
All right, there we go. So, realryanmccurdy.com.
Yeah.
And okay, so in honor of Troy, he usually closes. Troy is our usual host. I'm filling in. I'm losing my hosting virginity right now. I host other things. I'm losing my interviewing virginity right now.
Enthusiastic consent is sexy.
Yeah. So I'm enthusiastically losing my interviewer virginity. And so this is my first time as an interviewer. I hope I did okay. I think it was good, right?
Yeah, you did a great job.
Yeah, thank you. You did a great job too. So, but Troy, who's the regular interviewer and host and MC, he usually gives a closing thought. He usually asks the interviewee, the artist, just what advice would you give to everybody who's an artist? Just like what would be your motto and your kind of mantra that you would pass on to other people as something that could help them?
I would say the world desperately needs what you alone can create, so keep going.
All right.
Yeah.
Ryan McCurdy, realryanmccurdy.com at our Funk Family Showcase. Bye, everyone.